It's just so ridiculous that it's entertaining. What's up, guys? I'm Garrett Marchesano, and this is the MMA Rundown brought to you by FanDuel. We're going to talk about one topic for 3 minutes and then move on to the next one. Let's go. All right, first up, we got UFC Fight Night Recap, main event, Thompson versus Neal. This was a heck of a fight. Went all five rounds. It did end up going to the finish line with Thompson getting the win by decision. If we look back to last week's fight picks with the pros, Chris ended up calling this one pretty dead on. He stretched it out, said it would go all five rounds, and said it would end up being Thompson on top, getting that decision win. So, Chris, how'd you break it down like that? And the fight played out just like you said it would. What were you thinking when you made that pick?
Yeah, I'm very familiar with Thompson's style and, you know, how he fights. And I knew his footwork and his range, his pop shotting and his angles were going to be a little bit too much for Jeff Neal to handle. There's levels to the striking game. There's levels to, you know, the grappling game. And, you know, Wonderboy is at a way different level than a lot of these guys that are, you know, that are in his same weight class. So when guys just try to stand and strike with him, you know, they're playing into his game. Yeah. So, you know, he did exactly what I thought he was going to do. He played the footwork battle, the in and out. He worked, you know, he worked his jabs, his pulls off the jabs, and he was getting an angle and shooting those right hands and those just pop shots, getting the angle and pop shotting again, always creating the angle. So Jeff was having, you know, a hard time finding him. And, you know, he was getting flustered, right? He would like try to pin him against the cage, and you know, Wonderboy would just bounce off and keep doing the same thing. So in my opinion, it kind of went like picture perfect what I thought was going to happen. And you know, I'm happy to see Wonderboy, you know, with two wins in a row now, back on track.
Yeah, I think he's probably a fight or two away from getting another title shot. And, you know, I had the chance to talk to Anthony Pettis last week, one of the only guy ever to finish Wonderboy by knockout. And he said when he fought with him, he just has some of the strangest range in the UFC. You know, he's trying to test his range and get his timing down. He said all of a sudden I'd get hit by a right jab out of nowhere from the southpaw stance from Wonderboy. And it's like he couldn't even see it coming. So same thing with Jeff Neal. It seems like he couldn't get the shots off to get off in the inside. You know, I listen to the corner in between rounds. It's so good to hear their knowledge. They're saying to the fighters, and they're trying to get Jeff Neal to get off, you know, four, five, six punches at a time to get on the inside and land some shots. And he just couldn't do it. He'd throw a few punches and stop. And then right when he's in range, Wonderboy faints or does a little back step, and he's right back out of range again. And so really sneaky feints. And just like Anthony Pettis said, he keeps that real wide base. So it's hard to get on the inside, and he's always so well balanced. So kudos to Wonderboy. After the fight, he did call out, you know, Jorge Masvidal.
Yeah, that was cool. I like that.
And so I'm glad to hear him do a call out. And, you know, we might have the BMF versus
NMF. Yeah. I wasn't sure what he meant by that. I was like, NMF.
Yeah.
But then they broke it down. I was like, ah, that kind of makes sense.
Yeah. And Ariel Helwani actually gave Wonderboy a belt that says NMF, nicest mother. Uh-huh. And it was like, the UFC can take that. Let's take that UFC. Let's spin it. Let's have those two belts up against each other. And I'd love to see Jorge run it back. And on Jorge's side, he said in an interview that he wants to get that fight back. You know, he lost via decision to Wonderboy. Let's run it back again. They're both at the top of their game. It'd be a great fight. You know, it'd be a fan favorite fight. It'd be fun to watch. I think the winner of that gets right back up there and they're into title contention.
Yeah, I agree. You know, Steve Wonderboy's got two in a row. I'm not sure exactly how many Masvidal has in a row now, but, you know, I know he's right there in line.
Yeah.
So I think that can definitely be here in the near future. I want to see it. Let's make it happen, matchmakers. Let's get the BMF versus the NMF.
That's a tough one. Yeah, he's coming off of one loss against Usman, but he took that fight on short notice, went out to Fight Island, and that was a tough loss. But he's still right up there, top ranked guy. Both great names. I agree. UFC, let's make that happen. Dana Shelby, book that fight. So next topic we got up, we want to review a couple other notable fights on the card from our fight picks last week. One is Greg Hardy loses via second round TKO to Tybura. This was a tough one. You know, I'm a big Greg Hardy fan. I love the knockout power in both hands, and he comes out aggressive. I like his football background. I know he's fighting through some adversity outside the ring. He's got good mentors. He came in as the heavy favorite. You know, I liked him in this fight. But again, Chris, you know, you called the main event, and then coming in this fight, you know, you did predict that Hardy would gas and that, you know, he'd take the L in this one. So explain to me your thought process on this fight.
Yeah, and honestly, I was kind of like at the edge of my seat because Greg was putting it on to Bora. Like in the beginning of the fight, I was like, oh no, you know, Greg Hardy came in shape and he came ready. But, you know, after that first round, you know, in getting into the second round, you can just start, you know, that energy meter. It's like, you know, you play Street Fighter, you know, like you're using all your moves, all your super moves, and then your energy level's like this, and then you get hit or you get taken down, and that's exactly what happened. As soon as he got put on his back, he didn't have the energy anymore to get back to his feet. He didn't have the energy more to stop, you know, Tibura's, you know, offense, ground and pound, and it looked like just a big balloon got deflated.
Yeah, it's really tough, and it's hard to be a fan because even in the last fight, even in his wins, he was so exhausted in his last fight, he could barely give the post-fight interview because he had to catch his breath. And, you know, he's one of the few heavyweights that cuts down to 265. So that tells me he's coming in at 280, 290, or even more to cut down. So I love to see Greg Hardy hit that bike, hit the cardio. I know a lot of the big guys don't want to do that. They want to focus on their striking, and they feel so energetic and powerful to start off the fight, but it's going to pay dividends in that second, third round, or God forbid if he's ever in a five-round match, you know, the goal is going to be to bring him into deep water. So he's got to know every opponent from here on out is going to try to pull him to those deep rounds and get him tired. He's just was so exhausted. So Greg Hardy, work on your cardio. I'm rooting for you. I know you're going to get back in the mix and get some wins here. Next fight we want to go over is Jose Aldo. A lot of us were pulling for Jose. I know Max Griffin had Vera win in this fight. You know, Jose looked great. He surprisingly, you know, a lot of people were looking at him in that bantamweight division at 135. He already cut a lot of weight for featherweight, and so a lot of people were concerned. But he's been looking great at 135. He's been making the weight no problem. His physique looks good. His energy looks good. You know, and he came out, and he put on a great performance. So what do you think about Jose?
I was one of those guys that were concerned if Jose was going to make 135. I knew he was a big 145er when he fought at featherweight, and I was like, there's no way this guy is going to make 135. And then, you know, I saw kind of the lead up. The dude was looking really sucked in, like leading up to his fights, and, you know, his facial features were kind of already sticking out. I was like, man, he's going to have trouble. But he's made it happen, you know, multiple times now, and, you know, it's probably just getting easier for him. And I think a lot of times it's, you know, just either a nutritional change or just working with a coach who knows the nutrition game, who knows the weight cutting game. Because I know for a fact a lot of these Brazilians do it the old school hard way of like trying to keep as much water like on water as possible. Bloating, then they just try to cut it all at the end. And, you know, I don't think that's the healthiest thing to do nowadays, now that everyone's a little bit more educated on the subject.
Yeah, I agree. So hopefully he's doing it the right way. I mean, he looks good. The energy looks good. So I'm excited for Jose and see what he does next fight. Now this will build some good promotion, good hype behind him. So I look forward to see who he faces next. Last note we want to add real quick is, you know, we have to mention Rob Font, who is pretty much off the radar in the UFC. You know, not many people who are UFC fans. If you said, hey, tell me about Rob Font, probably wouldn't know about him. But, you know, he was 11-4 coming in this fight. He's been in the UFC for about 6 years and, you know, has some good fights under his belt. Now this is his biggest name to date, Marlon Moraes, and he came out there and just let his hands go. So, Chris, what do you think about that?
I'm super happy for Rob Font. You know, he came out to the team, you know, right before he got in the UFC, probably, you know, seven years ago or so, and we got to train a little bit. I was like, man, this guy is good. He's got some skills. And, you know, probably within the next year, he was in the UFC. And now he's still in the UFC 6 years later. And I know how hard it is to stay in at that level. And he's doing all the right things. He's training with the right coaches. He's training with Cater. So I know, like, you know, Cater's a beast. So I know whatever Cater's doing, you know, Rob Font's doing as well. And you can see that in his fights. But, yeah, that jab, man, he was landing that jab on Marlon. I think, you know, once he landed that jab a couple of times and Marlon felt his power, that just started setting up all his other shots and, you know, set up that big uppercut, that rocked him there. And then he just pounced on him. And once Marlon was hurt, it kind of, you know, actually, you know, me looking back at that, I honestly felt after that first grappling exchange, when Marlon took him down, if you notice when Marlon got back up, he was already like at half speed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, boom, comes out really explosive. Yeah. And this happens to him a lot. If you notice, he comes out really hard, but after that first big initial onslaught, his energy level goes tremendously down. And I think if you rewatch the fight after that first grappling exchange and Rob got back to his feet, I was like, ooh, Marlon looks like he's a little slower now.
Yeah,
and then he started getting popped a little bit more. His movement wasn't there anymore. And then that's what set up, you know, that those combinations by Rob.
Yeah, Marlon's always coming out with the heavy power. And yeah, when he gets in those grappling exchanges, gets taken out, it seems like his energy diminishes pretty quickly. So tough one for Marlon. You know, he's coming off the spinning back kick KO loss to Sanhagen, now followed up by a TKO loss to Rob Font. You know, he was the number one contender, top contender, number three coming in this fight. Now he drops down to number seven. You know, he's still in the top 10 in that bantamweight division. You know, rightfully so. He's still one of the top guys in the world. Two fight skid here, so I'm hoping, you know, he gets it together. It's now time to go back to his camp and his coaches and make the changes necessary to kind of get back on track. So I'll be curious to who they match him up with next. And for Rob Font, now he jumps in the rankings, number five in the bantamweight division. So big kudos to him. Has to be a big time for him and his team. And
called, you know, out TJ. Did you see that?
Yeah, yeah. And I was just going to say, now I'm excited to see who he fights next. Before I'd be, Rob Font, let's see what he has against Marlon. Now it's like, I'm a fan of this guy. He gained a new fan in me. I like to see him mixed up with TJ. I think that'd be a fun fight. I know TJ's looking for a fight. And heck yeah, Rob Font in the bantamweight division. Let's stack on to already stacked division. I like it. All right, next up we got Anthony Pettis, who was our three-way lock of the week last week. I was actually fortunate enough to reach out to his manager and get him on the show as well. Did an interview with them, and he chose himself for the lock of the week. And then we had Josh Emmett pick Anthony, and then we also had Chris pick Anthony Pettis as lock of the week. So for me, as the producer behind the screen here, I was really pulling for Anthony. I'm a huge fan of him, regardless of picking him or not. He's always fun to watch. You know, he brings those Showtime moves. And like you said last week, Chris, it's always exciting. Never a dual fight with Andy Pettis because he can pull out those spinning kicks and
which,
you know,
he
wheel
almost
kicks.
Did. And we'll talk about.
He says he wants to save his real flashy stuff for end of the rounds, which he did. Yeah, we'll mention that in a few moments. But, you know, he came in this fight against Alex Morono. And to be honest, the start of the fight off, Alex was bringing that forward pressure, pressuring Anthony, you know, landed more shots, cut him early, got a takedown early. And then it was really end of the first, second, and third, Anthony started taking over the fight, winning the scrambles, really controlling the cage. And the scrambles is where I saw the most advancements by Anthony. He was getting in trouble, but then he could always scramble out of it. So for you, Chris, watching Anthony and how he ran into some trouble in the first round, and from your own experience, what was going through his mind when he was kind of, he knows he was losing that round, going through some adversity? To me, it was kind of like his veteran, you know, mindset to get past that. What helped him pull through and win round two and three?
Yeah, so I can speak on a lot, you know, from this fight, just, you know, leading up. After watching the interview with Ariel, like, we did the show, and then I didn't see that interview, but then when I watched the interview, I, you know, found out he's working with a mental coach and, you know, working on a ton of stuff with that. And I could definitely hear it in the interview, and, you know, I can see that mental change. And sometimes that's a huge difference for us fighters, or, you know, for guys that are fighting. And then, you know, talk about the first round, I think he tried to throw something flashy and slipped.
Yeah.
And then Alex jumped on him and took advantage of that. Took his back, hit him with a good shot to the nose, started making his nose bleed. Yeah. But, you know, I can tell in Anthony, you know, from his interview, he's like, all right, focus on being in the present. All right, you know, you got your back taken, calm, focus, you're in the present, let's work out of this. And it's only the first round. And Alex did a great job of keeping that position. But, you know, as a true vet, you know, as Pettis is he weathered the storm.
Yep.
He lost that first round. But he came back that second round and start implementing his game. He's like, all right, no more of this flashy stuff right off the bat. Let's get serious and let's start winning this fight. And I think also, you know, the new work with Robert Drysdale. He's working with Robert Drysdale in Vegas. I think Anthony is spending a lot of time in Las Vegas now, and, you know, working with Robert Drysdale and some other people out there. So I can see that his ground game has always been good, but I can tell, you know, a few things from his ground game. He definitely sharpened up with Robert Drysdale and those guys. And as you can see, that second and third round, he pulled away, was really landing some effective strikes, and then winning the grappling exchanges. And then talk about that near spinning kick that almost finished him, man. Like, That would have been that would have been awesome if he would have got that finish in that third.
It was almost exactly what he was talking when I was talking to him. He said, you know, when I hear that end of the round, there's 10 seconds left, you'll see me throwing some showtime stuff, those spinning kicks, the jumping off the fence type stuff. He even in the fight, he did like a rolling, he like did a somersault to a kick. Just some, he has some wild stuff in his toolbox. But yeah, when that was coming, 20 seconds left, hit that spinning kick, nicked him on the head. Alex started getting wobbly. Yeah. He was going, he came in, threw another big punch, seconds away from getting the finish. But I feel like the old Anthony Pettis, you know, after he lost that first round, would maybe sit on those big punches and try to throw a big overhand right KO or big something, big spinning kick to finish the fight.
Yeah.
The new Anthony Pettis with his mindset, you know, he hunkered down, used his veteran skills, and just, you know, outpointed him in the second round and in the third round to get the win. So big kudos to Anthony. I hope he carries this mindset in his next fight. And he did announce that he's moving down from welterweight to back to lightweight, 155. He wants a guy up there in the top 10. You know, he wants to get in there fight and get there right into title contention. Now he's going through contract negotiations, so we'll see if the UFC is going to be able to keep him around. He did call out Tony Ferguson, which I do think would be a great fight in the lightweight division.
Yeah, I would love to see that fight.
And, you know, Tony is coming off two losses. Anthony Pettis, you know, he's still building up his name, got a few good wins. And if he gets a win over Tony Ferguson, he's right there in the top five mix, talking about a title shot. All right, next we got up Cowboy Cerrone taps RDA at Submission Underground this past weekend. Submission Underground number 19. So Rafael Dos Anjos took a grappling match against Cowboy Cerrone. These are always fun to watch, especially when we get some big UFC names in the mix. Ended up, Cowboy submitted him in overtime the first time, but there was some controversy around this. RDA said he didn't tap. They said he did. And so they let the whole event play out, and then they had some extra time in the main event spot, and they actually ran it back again. So, Chris, you were actually watching this Submission Underground. Yeah. What did you think about the first match? And then tell us about the drama that went into the second match.
This was great. As you can tell, I have a huge smile on my face just because I thought it was, like, super entertaining just how everything went down. Not only it was a great match, like RDA versus Cowboy, great match. It ended up going the distance into the overtime rounds. And the way Submission Underground works is I think it's like a 5-minute round. And if there's no submission, you go into EBI overtime rules, which is you can either start on the back with your hooks or you start in an armbar position with the leg entangled. And you get three tries pretty much. And it either comes down to escape time. So if, you know, if I'm on your back for a minute long, you have to either escape in a shorter period of time or you have to submit me. Okay. Mm. So if we just keep escaping, and it goes, there's three rounds of overtime. If it keeps go back and forth, escape, at the end of it, if there's no submission, whoever has the less amount of time in that position wins. Okay. But if you submit your guy, like, you automatically win unless they submit you faster from that position.
Okay, got it. Because Ryan Bader and Rumble Johnson also competed on this card, and Bader won by escape time. So that explains it. They looked at escape time. His was less, and then he got the win.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And going back to the armbar, like, you know, Cowboy got out of RDA's armbar and then put him in one, and then got the tap, you know, and RDA tried to dispute it and said he didn't tap. And they kept replaying it. It looked like a tap to me. Like, the arm was pretty dead to rights, and he tapped and then tried to roll out, which is, you know, the classic Brazilian. Yeah, like, we would call it, like, the Brazilian move. But, you know, it was funny because Chael was like, oh, you know, we're not going to run it back. Da-da-da-da, I can't do that.
Yeah.
And then after Rumble, he was like, they're going to run back the overtime round. I was like, yes. And then the exact same thing happened. It was funny. Yeah. Like, Cowboy got out of RDA's, and then Cowboy finished him even in a more decisive factor.
And he tapped for sure.
Tapped him for sure. And I almost felt bad for RDA, just like the embarrassment of, like, getting tapped by a Cowboy two times in a row.
I know. And I can tell by the way he was laughing it off and playing it off. He didn't say, I didn't tap that first one. He was walking away, big smiles. And I'm glad they got to run it back. So it's not like RDA can say, no, I never tapped, Cowboy. It'd be a kind of a thing between them. Now Cowboy goes, yep, you definitely did.
And not taking anything away from Cowboy. I know his ground game is super legit.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just saying, I know RDA was embarrassed to tap two times to the same move.
Yeah. So that's fun to watch. So I look forward to jumping on Fight Pass and watching more Submission Underground, especially I like to see those big UFC fighter names. But a lot of other talent on the card. And so that's a cool one. Who knows? We might even see our very own host, Chris Holdsworth, compete one day.
Hey, let's make it happen, Chell.
All right. Next one, we have to bring it up. I know a lot of you guys don't like us bringing this up, but the fact that Jake Paul did just an outrageous call out of Conor McGregor, you know, dissing him, dissing the Irish, talking about his wife, making a $50 million offer backed by a New York bank with a number for certificate of authentication so that Conor's team can call the bank and say, is that $50 million really there for me? So pretty wild that his team went through all this to make this offer to Conor. I get it, you know, if Jake Paul fights Conor, Conor's one of the most popular fighters in the world, if not the most popular fighter in the world right now. You know, that's a big money fight. That's going to be a $100 million plus type of fight. Jake would give the money away just to get the notoriety and to be able to get in the boxing ring with Conor. It'd be pretty epic. You know, a lot of other fighters are calling out Jake now. We know Logan just booked Floyd Mayweather. Chris, what the hell is going on with this influencer world, with the Logan Paul brothers? You know, you got Dylan Danis in the mix, all sorts of stuff going on. Is Conor going to take a fight against Jake Paul? No response from Conor to this point. What do you think about Jake Paul, his recent win over Nate Robinson, and him trying to fight all these other UFC fighters?
Yeah, it's the entertainment business, right? Like, we're here to be entertained. And, you know, if promoters can make money off of fights and, you know that they can sell tickets, they're going to make it happen. Like, promoters are, you know, probably the guys who want to make the most money in general, you know? I think it's good overall for the sport. A couple different reasons. For one, MMA guys are going to get paid. You know, they go into the boxing ring. I know it's kind of like, oh, I'm fighting a YouTuber or whatever, but like, dude, like, you're fighting to get paid. Like, this is why we fight.
Yeah.
You know, like, and who cares? Like, put it on the line. And even though the guy's not like a traditional fighter per se, he's got a huge following, a huge influencer, and you're probably going to steal a lot of his followers and work your brand up from that fight and also get paid a ton of money. So I think it's a good thing for these MMA guys to get these cross promoted like type boxing fights. I want to watch it.
Yeah.
You know, Conor versus Jake, like I would pay to watch it. I don't know what Conor has to gain from it besides the whole money and maybe a little bit of notoriety, but like going from fighting Floyd to Jake Paul, like I don't think Conor's going to do it, in my opinion. I think he's going to focus on MMA for a bit. And maybe if another opportunity maybe comes, he might take it. But I don't know.
It's interesting. It's such a big payday. And, you know, for these guys, let's say if you're a guy making $100,000 a fight in the UFC and you have a YouTuber call you out to potentially make, you know, in the multi-millions, you'd be a fool not to take a serious look at it. And for all the people out there hating on it, it's ruining boxing, I would never watch that fight, can't believe it. Those people are tuning in too. You know, their buddies are buying the pay-per-view. They're going over. They're not missing that. They're watching all the highlights. You can't help but be attracted to the hype leading up to the fight, all the smack talk. It's just so ridiculous that it's entertaining. And these guys actually, it's not like they're coming in. And actually, these Logan Paul and Jake Paul, these guys aren't, you know, small dudes. These are big guys who've been boxing. They have that puncher's chance. So it makes you think anything can happen. I want to see Nate Diaz called out Jake Paul, says he needs to get his ass beat.
I'll be sick.
Nick Diaz needs some extra money. He hasn't fought in a couple years. Let's see Nate Diaz versus Jake Paul and Nick Diaz versus Logan Paul mid-2021. Everyone's going to get cashed out in the multi-millions, and the shit talk leading up to that fight would be absolutely epic. It'd be fun to watch, and the Diaz brothers beat the hell out of the Paul brothers. Who knows? Maybe something happens.
Bros versus bros. That would brothers versus brothers. Let's make that happen. Yeah. I would want to see that more than, you know, Jake versus Conor, in my opinion.
I agree. That the promotion behind that would be unreal. All the promos would be epic. And I know we're going long on this, but the last thing we're gonna say is Jake Paul's team actually sent a contract over to another familiar UFC fighter, Michael Bisping. And I listened to Michael Bisping's podcast, and he was completely transparent and mentioned, he said, hey, I thought it was a joke. You know, I'm calling out. I love to fight him. Guess what? Yesterday, a contract showed up to my door, and my team's looking at it, and Michael's saying, I'm going to sign the contract and send it back to him. He wants to fight Jake Paul. And for Michael Bisping, here's a great example. You know, he was making in the hundreds of thousands, especially towards the end when he got the championship. Let's say it was, you know, $400,000 a fight. You know, they make these salaries public nowadays. I'm sure you guys can look it up. He was making good money, but for a guy like Michael Bisping, recently retired, he's probably getting an offer in the multi-million dollar range. Can you doubt the guy? I think a lot of people are going to hate on Bisping for taking the fight or signing this contract. Who knows if it's all going to come together? They're looking at March 28th for the fight. I can't hate on Michael for taking
me
a multi-million
either.
Dollar
Take fight.
Take
that fight, Michael.
There.
Get paid and
big boxing gloves
yeah,
on.
Yeah, like you got a family, man. Like, you know, make the right choices. I know he's just coming off knee surgery, so I'm not sure like where his, you know, his healing process and recovery is at. So, you know, March is, you know, is right around the corner. So, you know, hopefully, you know, he's ready to go by then because I'm paying to watch that fight too.
No, that'll be interesting. It's inevitable that Jake is going to pull one of these MMA guys. I know he's negotiating with Ben Askren, Michael Bisping. He's really trying to get to Conor. One of these guys is going to take the fight. You know, money talks, and it's only a matter of time before we hear that official announcement. And it could even be Michael Bisping. So we'll see how it plays out. All right, next up, you know, it is winding down to the end of the year here, end of 2020, wild year with everything that's going on. It was a huge year for the UFC. They're one of the few promotions that did not shut down. They ended up doing 41 events this year, 11 pay-per-views.
It's crazy.
And, you know, they average over the years about 40 events per year, so it wasn't like they did half the events they usually do. They had a record year as far as social media impressions, numbers in the multi-billions. Throughout all their social media channels, which is absolutely ridiculous. UFC Fight Island was a huge hit for social media. Yeah. Everything that revolved around that, it allowed the international fighters to still meet and fight. And in the beginning, when they couldn't get those fights on in Vegas, and so Dana again fixed that. And then for the UFC in Vegas, for the fighters in the United States, they started doing the productions out of the Apex Center and running it all themselves. No relying on anybody but themselves for the promotion. So what do you think about the UFC and keeping it going this year? Dana White leading the ship and just keeping a huge 2020 for the promotion.
Yeah, they did. They made some epic moves this 2020. Not only, you know, working around all these, you know, these obstacles as far as, you know, the pandemic and everything and keeping the show running. But, you know, I was fortunate enough to be like on one of the first shows in Jacksonville when everything opened back up and, you know, saw how the UFC was, how serious they were taking things and, you know, going to the Apex and seeing the UFC just like rented out their whole hotel and hosted all the fighters and cornermen and like literally just have a hub and just doing everything out of the Apex and the UFC PI. And now I'm hearing that they're going to build their own hotel.
Yeah,
so they're going to be like solely self-sufficient, which is going to be huge for the company, and that's just going to help them grow and make more money because they're not going to have to, you know, pay for rooms and all that now. So, you know, super epic year for the UFC. They were the only sports playing at that time, so of course they're going to bring in all the the impressions and the social media. Like, no one else has anything to watch.
Oh yeah,
you know, so like you gotta think about those type of eyes and numbers that they were getting.
All the sports books were only betting on MMA and UFC. It exploded. Yeah. They no other sport to bet on. So the UFC was there. It jumped up big time. You know, we're a Fight Pick show on the other side of things too. So that was big for us to just cover that. And yeah, it was just super impressive. Sorry to interrupt you, Chris, but it just they had all eyes in it. And it's good to note that, you know, these other promotions, the PFL, ONE Championship, you know, they're trying to get back in the mix, but they couldn't find a way to stay open. Dana was ruthless and relentless to save his jobs of his UFC employees and for the fighters who need to fight to make money. You know, he wouldn't let anything stop him. So got to give it to Dana, too.
Yeah. You know, a lot of these other organizations don't have the UFC money either. So maybe that, you know, reason why they couldn't make things happen. But, you know, I think this is probably one of the most pivotal moves by UFC in the most recent years as far as staying open, keeping the fights going and, you know, keeping people entertained with a bunch of great fights.
All right, last topic we have here is the triple header set for January. So, you know, it's the end of the year. Things are starting to wind down. This is a time where a lot of people take a lot of time off, time to take a couple weeks off, be with family and friends, celebrate Christmas, the new year. I'm all for it, but, you know, business never stops. And I'm always looking, you know, what's coming next? What are the next fights? You know, what's going on in the UFC world? And the next fight we have to look forward to is the Max Holloway versus Calvin Kattar fight, which is already extremely exciting, coming on January 16th. But it looks like with the rebooking of Khamzat Chimaev versus Leon Edwards is they just booked that for January 20th, right in between the Max Holloway and the Conor McGregor fight. So they stacked up this week for a triple header week So starting off with Max Holloway versus Calvin Kattar, what do you think about that matchup, Chris?
Man, I'm a big fan of both of the guys. You know, Kattar's been on a tear. You know, Holloway, you know, is always super impressing. Man, this is gonna be a boxing match, in my opinion. It's gonna be a battle of who can be effective with their strikes. They're both around the same height, and I'm not sure who's got the better reach. But it's gonna be an interesting fight, in my opinion, because they're both like really good strikers, and they have a good ground game, but they don't really, you know, try to take things to the ground.
Yeah, they're both gonna stand.
I think this is gonna be a stand and bang type of fight, which is, you know, always great to watch. It's always super entertaining. You know, Kattar's got a lot of power behind those combinations, and you know, Max is more the type of guy to just, you know, pop shot you to death until want to give up or your face is just look like it melted off. But it's gonna be a clash of the stand-up war, and I'm super excited for that fight.
It's going to be a great fight. You know, Holloway's coming in as the -196 favorite in this fight. Heavy favorite. Kattar's the +164 underdog. I feel like people always underestimate Calvin Kattar. In every fight, they're always picking against him.
I'm like, damn, I know I shouldn't have. Nah, I'm not. Kattar, man, I can't bet against you anymore. But, you know, Max is my boy, so it's kind of like.
That's always the situation. The other one we got, Khamzat Chimaev. He's coming in. This is another one where I'm surprised he's coming in as the big -178 favorite coming in the fight. When you got Leon Edwards, I believe he's on an 8-fight win streak. He's fighting bigger names, +150 underdog. It's just absolutely wild. I know Khamzat is the potential, you know, breakout fighter of the year. 3 wins on, you know, short notice fights, and he gets them all by finish, you know, knockout, TKO, and a decision. Oh, is it a submission?
I think he submitted the guy.
I think all three. All three by finish.
Could be wrong, but like. It's hard not to believe the hype, right? Yeah. Like, you're coming off 3 big wins, and you know what he's done before. It's hard not to believe that and be like, oh, he hasn't fought anybody tough or anybody ranked, because that's always what we say as fans or you know, people who follow the sport. But at the same time, it's like you know, Leon Edwards is at a different level than those guys he's been fighting. So it's going to be a huge jump in level and skill. And you know, I'm interested to see if Khamzat can adjust and use that same type of game and just demolish, you know, Leon when it comes to the grappling.
If he does, that would be absolutely wild. His confidence is at an all-time high, of course. If he wins the breakout fight of the year, it'll even stack on to his accolades for 2020. It's definitely an exciting fight, and he's a fun fighter to promote. The UFC is definitely getting behind him, and for good reason. And I like with him being the hype train and Leon Edwards kind of being the black horse of the division. I like the matchup. It's kind of like, you know, let's see what happens. So super excited for that fight. I like that they put it right in between an epic fight week, and they didn't push it off to later in the year or like, you know, February, March. They rebooked it as soon as possible. And the last one is Conor McGregor, you know, coming out as a big favorite, -250 against Dustin Poirier. Again, not giving Poirier much credit. Now I think these lines are going to close as we get closer to the fight. I think it'll be more like a, you know, -120, you know, +100 type of odds. But this is pretty wild. This is the fight I'm looking forward to most in January. I'm interested to see how it shakes up with Conor. If he gets the win, I think he's going to be the title shot guy right after that versus Habib or whoever else they put up, Charles Oliveira, whoever it may be. So super exciting fight. The implications of this fight are going to shake up that lightweight division. What are your thoughts on that, the Conor fight?
Yeah,
I know we've talked about it before.
I think everyone's looking forward to the Conor Poirier rematch. I think everyone's looking forward to Conor coming back in general. He's got a huge fan base, and you know, just what he's done in the UFC already is just like we all want to watch it. You know what I mean? Like, double champ, just starching people left and right. You know, beating some of the best guys around. It's like, does Conor still have it? You know, can he still do that to the top guys in the division? You know, had a little layoff. You know, he did his whiskey thing. He's probably a billionaire right now, and he doesn't need to fight for the money. You know, he's at the stage now where he's fighting for the love of the game.
Yeah, for the legacy.
Yeah, man. And you know, I respect that, because like, I don't know, man. If I was a billionaire, I would probably be sitting on some island somewhere, but. And then looking at the other side of things, like the martial artist in me is like, I don't know, man, I still would want to test my skills and show people that, you know, I'm still the best in the world. So I'm super pumped for that fight. I think it's going to be a different fight than the first fight. You know, Conor, of course, was just coming in the UFC. It was pretty raw still, and I know he's got a ton better. And I think the same with Dustin.
Yeah, same
like,
with Dustin. Yeah.
Dustin was, like, still pretty raw, and he's got a ton better. I think Dustin's been through some more wars. Yeah. You know, he's got some more mileage. But, you know, that's just going to be experience. I think it's going to be a different fight this time.
Yeah, I think since they fought, Dustin's taken about double the amount of fights as Conor. And he went on a ridiculous win streak after he fought Conor. I believe it was 12 fights in a row. Now he's, you know, lost against Khabib. But this is going to be, like you said, this is going to be like the first fight. I think it's going to be an all-out brawl. I think it'll be a lot of feints and them filling out each other in the beginning of the fight. But this is going to be a five-round fight. I think someone's getting finished. Either way it goes. I'm a huge Dustin Poirier fan. You know, I'm also a huge Conor fan, so it's hard. I'm in a tough place with this one. I think it's going to end up Conor getting the finish late in the fight. But we'll see if my mind changes getting closer to the fight. But I'm excited to see that one. What a hell of a way to end that triple header on the week with the Conor McGregor main event fight.
Yeah, I'm stoked for January.
Yeah, it's going to be cool. Thanks for watching the FanDuel MMA Rundown. We'll see you next year.